Hello, welcome. I'm happy you are interested in the methodology of L-Ballet. This is my first talk about methodology. And in these talks, I give you more inside information about the things we are doing and how we are doing and why we are doing them. But first, we have to define. When we are talking together, we have to talk the same language. So you have to know which names we are using for positions, for movements, for dance steps. And in this talk, I will explain what we with L-Ballet are using. So I start with the definitions of the positions of both the feet and the arms. The arms are going to be in the second talk, and now we talk about the positions of the feet. In general, we have 5 turned out positions. And in fact, it would be better to speak about the positions of the legs, because the turning out happens not in the feet, not in the knees, but in the hips, the turning out happens, and the feet are a result of the turning out. To start from the top with the first position, the heels are together and 10 toes are looking outward. You're standing a little bit of the weight on the heels, then on 4 balls of 2 feet and 10 toes. The second position is initiated from the first or the fifth position. You make a tendu à la seconde, and where the toes are, the foot comes down. You can start whether from fifth or from first, that doesn't matter. But the hips are in between both legs, and the most made mistake in classical ballet is to take the position too wide, because you always have to move, to be able to move upwards. When your position is too wide, it is too much effort to go up. So then there is only one possibility, it's turning in the legs or giving your buttocks backwards to get up, and you can imagine that's wrong. So please always remember only where the toes are in a correct place, but maintendu seconde, there your heel go down, and that's your second position. Also think about point work. How can you do a relevé point work with a too wide position? It's impossible. So the next one is the third one. And I seldom use the third position, because it's a difficult one. It seems easy because it's not so very crossed as a fifth. The front foot is with the heel in front of the hollow of the leg that is behind. But the problem is with third position that you have to shift your weight when you go on one leg. When I go on one leg from third, I really have to shift on my supporting leg, and then I come back on 2 legs. So it's not so convenient as a fifth, but I will talk about the fifth later. A third is a position you can escape for people who have a limited turnout in the hips. Sometimes a third position is used instead of a fifth position. The fourth position, I say now fourth position, but we have 2 of them. The fourth position opposite first position is you go whether to the front or to the back. Now I go to the front from first, where the heel is, the foot comes down. So this position is like the second with the hips in between the feet. But my feet are outside the hips, like in second. So, like in second, we do not have a real grand plié, because there's no use to lift your heels. And in the cross position and in first, you have a grand plié going from the floor with the heels. This first position, this force opposite first, looks easy. But it's very difficult. Look, when I go on one leg, I not only have to shift backwards or to the front, but I always also have to shift my weight on the ball of the foot. On the ball of the foot. So I not only have to shift my weight backwards or forwards, but also to the side. In a crossed fourth position, we don't have this problem. Then you are opposite fifth, so your upper legs, your thighs are really crossed. And you take a tendu to the front where the heel is. At the side of the heel, your foot comes down. Your hips are in between the legs. And when you take now about mount tendu, I am really placed with my weight, whether on the back foot or on the front foot. But the fourth position is the last one to learn for the pupils, because it's the most difficult one. It needs a feeling for coordination to work in force, because the front foot is like a tendu to the front. So in the hip, turned out, and the other one, the back foot, the back leg, is stretched in the front like a battement tendu derrière. And you can imagine what this makes a different feeling in your body, especially when you use a demi-plié and a grand plié force. Then we go to the fifth, and in the fifth, that's the most convenient position to move from, because you are really on the balls of both feet. Your legs are crossed. I'm always placed with my full body on the supporting leg, because it doesn't matter when I go out with the front leg or out with the back leg. Look, my head is staying. I am on my feet. There is a thing you should think about. Your thighs should not grab together. I see that much often with pupils. You have to open both thighs from the inside. The left one goes to the left armpit, and the right one is going to the right armpit. And then you get a free feeling in your legs. They can go outward, they can lift, they can do everything you want. And that's a very important thing, you can imagine. Now, another thing to remember is your hips are bones. They cannot move. So do not try to manage your feet by twisting your hips. A bone cannot move. So in your pelvis, there is no possibility to turn out. It's the thigh in the ball of the pelvis. So your hips are always in first. Whether your legs are in second, in fourth, in third, in fifth, your hips cannot move. They are always in first position. Then I have a little tip. When you have pupils who are turning to an exaggerated point, I show you. I exaggerate my first now. Then ask them to lift 10 toes. Look what's happening. They're coming back to their natural turnout. But don't forget then after to give the weight again outwards through the toes to the sides. Now I hope it's clear. Otherwise you can contact me by website. And the next talk we will have about the positions of the arms. Thank you very much.